committees are formed. In fact, there are three high power committees on technology only. I have a humorous definition of committee. Come, meet, tea. In fact, I said if 5,000 years from now somebody had to dig up Central Vista in Delhi and they uncover cups and saucers like Mohenjo-Daro, and they will come to conclusion, say, oh, here must be a room where they must have come from meeting and having a cup of tea.
Thank you for joining the Transform Impossible, which is India's first future tech, deep tech, emerging tech meets sustainability podcast. And today I'm super delighted to have with me Mr. Hemant Parekh, who has 30 years of experience with India's largest engineering company, Larsen & Toubro. He's been the executive director at 3P Consultants and founder at Recruit Group. He's a blogger, change maker, crusader who sends out weekly emails to India's Prime Minister Mr. Narendra Modi and other politicians filled with insights on ways to improve governance, infrastructure, business and society at large. Basically, he shares a roadmap backed with data to build a better, smarter, future-ready India. I would like to quote the great Mahatma Gandhi here. If you want to change the world, be that change. And Mr. Hemant Parekh leads by example. He's an inspiration. And this June 27th, he turns 88 years old. So happy birthday, sir. It's a pleasure and an honor to have you on the show. Let's start with what drives you to do what you do.
Thanks, Eddie, for all the kind words, many of which I don't deserve. You mentioned about Mahatma Gandhi. I am no saint, nowhere to emulate him, except I do want to mention that I did sit at the feet of Mahatma Ji or one hour, about 10 feet away from him, during one of his prayer meetings in the evening at Birla Mandir in Mumbai. This must be sometimes in 1944-45. All my life, he made a deep influence on me. What motivates me? That could be any number of things. Only one thing which I will like to quote. Some time back, a friend of mine mentioned to me about a book by the title Dying Empty. Author is one Todd Henry. The gist of the book saying the author said, I have many ideas. What's the use if I take them with me to the grave? That's not going to benefit anybody. I might as well empty myself so that when I go to the grave, I am empty. I think that really appealed to me. Although I might have started practicing that way back, 8 years back when I launched my blogging site. But I think this is one of the important things. And somewhere I wrote in one of my blogs, I said, it is easy to say, who listens? It is easy to become a cynic and say, things will never change. It was very difficult to say, I will never give up. Even at the age of 84, because I wrote this 4 years back, and even if accused of invading the privacy of those dignitaries by sending to them unsolicited opinions. If I'm accused of that, fine, no problem. I urge the readers to exercise this, their birthright, which I learned to exercise in the streets of Bhavnagar in 1942 and joined processions as a child, asking the British to quit India. ICT and AI technology, which is about to bury the right to privacy, this is my personal opinion, has also made it so very easy for every citizen to speak up. And that is what would be my message to the people.
You are an inspiration. You know, I just wish that even 1% of India's population, if they emulate what you are doing, our country will be a global superpower. the book you mentioned about dying empty. What is the use of accumulating knowledge if you don't implement it? And you also said that it's so easy to become a cynic because, you know, we largely say, oh, the world is not going to change. Why should I make an effort? But it always starts with the self. If you change, the world changes. And we desperately need change. We have come to a point because of COVID that we've been thrusted into the world where digitization is going to be the next big thing. The good, it carries the good and the bad. The good that it's going to create huge transformations in our life. But the bad part is that everything's going to go away, you know, right from our privacies to so many things. So, but yes, we are entering some exciting space. So yes, I think great note to start on. And I just hope and I wish that the listeners emulate that at the age of 88, you have a passion of a 28. Yeah, I think you're saying something else.
No, I just wanted to cite a few examples of people who refused to be cynic and went out and do something. Mr. Sundar Bahuguna of Chipko died a few weeks back. But he believed in saving the jungles and trees. He did not think whether anybody would listen to him. Kailash Satyavarthy thought about saving children toiling in the fields and factories and do something to save their childhood. Muhammad Yunus thought of poor people and started the Grameen Bank system. I mean, you can go on.
Yes.
Many people. And if you only keep the... I have a photograph of my brother-in-law who was an ophthalmist doctor. He passed away at the age of 95 or so. He followed one saint, Ravi Shankar Maharaj, and he had built his own eye hospital. And one day, Maharaj told Dr. Doshi, what are you going to do with the hospital, all the money that you are earning? So he said, sir, can I have a piece of paper? He took a piece of paper, wrote down, from today, I abandon my ownership of the hospital and I hand over to the trust of Maharaj. And he, for the next 50 years of his life, worked on a salary of 700 rupees for the trust. I have his photograph in my table to inspire me every morning.
We need these great stories to be told to the youth so they understand that no matter how much capital you accumulate, it's useless if it's not used for the larger good. Let's talk about COVID at this point in time, you know, because India over the years had gained economical advantage, but in the recent years because of the pandemic, it has hit the economy terribly. While there are countries such as China, New Zealand, and there's so many others that are completely on track and recovered, and the economy is like really driving forward. Today, here in India, we have the highest number of COVID cases in the world, second only to America. Why do you think India has been the worst hit nation when it comes to the pandemic? What could it have done better to not be in such a bad shape?
It's in the hindsight, it is very easy to find fault with all that government could have done or did not do. So our bureaucracy was not ready. Our health services were not ready. But despite that, the worst thing was our people are not disciplined. You give example of China, New Zealand, and other countries, and you see that on the TV, the discipline with which those people carried out the orders of their governments religiously. Therefore, focus should be now on what can we do. I wrote about rationing of the vaccine about 6 or 8 months back, knowing that when there is a demand exceeding supply, there is bound to be black marketing and everything, and how to distribute it. But most important to me is now prepare ourselves to stop the third wave. And here we need predictive analysis based on massive data of our entire population, not only those who have been affected, not only those who are affected and given shots, even those who have not been infected, that means our whole 1.4 billion people, I have in one of my blog listed the parameters which we need to compile. And once we compile this and ask artificial intelligence to predict, we will know who will get infected, when he will get in, who means not necessarily an individual person, but even a group or community, when, where, how, and then be prepared in advance to take action to stop the third wave. I think that is what we need to focus. Cowin app portal had a problem which are being sorted out. Centralized purchase was suggested by me. It is being implemented. Disappointing thing is that government is now asking states not to publish vaccine usage stock data. We need more transparency. We don't need to hide things from people. In fact, to reach people who do not have mobiles, but who have TV sets at home, we have 210 million households with the TV sets. Practically, I think 800 crore people are having TV. What is stopping from starting an exclusive TV channel devoted to COVID? It can have sections, registration processes on COVID explained. Statistics are in another section, easy to understand by the people, state-wise, district-wise. There can be a section for expert advice for educating the people by live answering the question of the people, etc. My mobile is a small computer. My TV remote is a small computer.
Where there's a will, I think there's a way. You painted out, I mean, you spoke about so many ways where we could have a deeper connection, the government and the people connection, and try to solve the problem. You know, there is this tool, like you gave examples of so many different mediums that we have besides a phone, you know, and if it all could be leveraged, the reach could be larger, the engagement and the necessary and the valid information could go through the right information. At this point in time, like you said, there are people with fragmented approaches. Information itself is very fragmented. There's a team saying this is right. There is somebody saying this is right. So it's very difficult to kind of come to an understanding that, oh, this is what should be the step forward. You spoke about predictive analysis. Artificial intelligence, the technology is growing in such a huge way. Even if you leverage it in a small way, I think you rightfully pointed out, we will be able to understand which state is going to have a larger number of COVID cases, which state or section of people will have lesser chances of getting COVID, what should be done. And data today is the king. The more we follow data, more of our decisions would be 100% rather than being hopeful that, oh, this might work. If and only, you know, those suggestions that what you call as unsolicited opinions which you share with our policymakers, if they are implemented, there is so much change that we can bring about. At this point in time, at least for the vaccination, you know, most of the vaccinations currently are being hoarded by these private organizations and which are being sold to the public rather than being streamlined. Somehow, there is, because of a capitalist nature, the entire thing has become a business option. There are hospitals who are charging lakhs of rupees for COVID treatment. There are utility companies which were, at least here in Mumbai, instead of supporting when you were at the peak of the pandemic, had sent us hiked bills. There are these, I can go on and on, where people saw this as an opportunity, where drug stores were selling the drugs at a huge rate. So we need a system change, and there needs to be a check so that these very trying times for a nation shouldn't become an opportunity for these parasitic business people, according to you. What do you think can be done to reverse the impact? What concrete efforts you think the government, the people, and the businesses need to take to try and reverse the impact of the COVID? And what do you think will be the role of technology over there?
In that blog and email rationing of the vaccine in last July, I remember having mentioned that every vial should have a unique number. And like you today order a small pin from Amazon, maybe costing 5 rupees, you can still trace it.
Yes.
All the way from the Amazon's warehouse right to your doorstep.
Right.
Every moment where it is and whether I got it or not. Now, why is that so difficult? I mean, China has made tremendous progress with the QR code on every little thing. And they know precisely what you purchased, when you purchased, why you purchased, how you purchased, how often you purchased, how many quantity you purchased. They know your life's history of buying behavior. Now, what is so difficult to do that for vaccine? We call ourselves a software superpower. One thing I would like to mention here, Eddie, we have bridge falling down in Charni Road railway station, and for 2 years it doesn't come up.
Right.
You take an army commander, and while crossing border of Pakistani border, if he comes across a river, he gets his troops to build a bridge in 2 hours.
Exactly.
If we don't delegate decision making to bureaucrats, nothing is going to happen. Number two, if bureaucrats keep thinking, oh, if I take a decision and it goes bad, my neck will be in the noose, then also nothing is going to happen. In my 30 years with LMTA and 30 years with a 3P consultant, 60 years, I always encourage my subordinate to take a decision and saying bad decision is better than no decision, as long as it's an honest decision. I think, unfortunately, today, people who are trying to take honest decision are being pilloried by CVC, audit committee, this, that, etc. Who wants to take a decision? It's safer not to take a decision.
The system seems to be so corrupted. Is that, you know, when there is the few honest people who are, when they try to make a decision which is honest, it gets corrupted because the entire system is corrupted. So it's so very difficult to do the right thing. But I guess that's the only way to bring about change. We need more of people who, rather than wait, take decisions and implement things, because otherwise the train will move and we will have lost it, and there'll be other nations moving ahead, and then we'll be just sitting and complaining, oh, we could have been the next global power. There is so much. We have the demographic dividend today. We have the largest youth population in the world. They are asking questions, deeper questions. They want to bring about change, and they're waiting in the wings to do. And we have seen a population such as yourself who wants to bring about change and are leading this entire movement of asking questions by blogging, writing to the policymakers. What we need is a system where it all comes together. And I don't know how it's going to happen, but I'm hopeful that there is change that can really bring about transformation, which we really deeply need in India. Now, because of the pandemic, the unemployment rate is at an all-time high. The government says that they don't have the data. They don't have data on the job loss. They don't have the data of the migrant deaths. So there are migrants who have died walking from cities to their villages. And the stories that they give me chills. I've seen videos where there was this lady who was sitting in the middle of the road, and it seems she walked for hundreds of miles, and she was sitting and crying because one of her child was so tired by the exhaustion of walking that the child had died. And this lady was weeping, and sad state of affair that we Indians, who are saying that we have the potential to be the next superpower, don't respect our own life. India's citizens' life is so cheap that the government doesn't want to give the data on the migrant deaths or the job loss. What steps do you think the government should take to handhold the vulnerable and create an ecosystem that we boost the employment rate and bring things back to normal?
Today, on number of occasions, I mean, maybe 200 of my blogs and email, I have repeatedly said, we are adding 12 million people to our workforce every year. There is just no way either the government or the private sector can provide jobs in an organized sector to 12 million people. On top of it, industries are trying to automate and go for robots, which is further shrinking
the
job opportunity. My suggestion all along in each one of those 100 self-employment, gig economy, I have a pan bidi shop outside my house, a gala. Even to have that small gala, that fellow needs a lakh of rupees
right
for all the inventory that he has to hold, plus rent of the gala, etc. At other extreme, you go to a highly automated automobile factory with robots, etc. Capital investment per job would go to 5 crores. Just take any company's annual report balance sheet and divide the total capital employed by the number of people, and you will have the figures. Now, if you take the median of 1 crore, multiplied by 12 million by 1 crore, 12 million crore rupees, nobody else, neither the government nor the. And therefore, if there was a honesty and politicians had the courage, they would have to say, sorry, sir, forget about jobs and employment. We can only work to enable you to get self-employed. And I have made numerous suggestions for self-employment. I think we need to have the government get out of the way of the startup and let them do their job.
Right.
I have given an example of Israel.
Yes.
Israel says Netanyahu, for all his negative things, he said, when Narendra Modi went, he said, one of my company wants to sell rockets to you, I don't come in his way. I don't say it's a defense related high technology product and I will not allow. Let him. You want to buy that company, also buy him. This is the way to go.
You mentioned about, I mean, in the beginning, you said, you know, that unemployment, it is a problem. And with the automation, obviously, that's going to be a problem which we need to have a conversation, because I think what COVID has done is that it has pushed us to social distance. And with social distancing, what is going to happen is that there'll be less and less workers at the factories. There'll be more and more automation, because automation is cheaper. You don't have to, when you create robots and robots are working at the factories, you don't have to pay them provident fund. You don't have to pay them salaries. They work 24 hours and they keep on.
They don't get tired. They don't take leave.
Right, exactly. So
automation. Fall sick.
Exactly. So
automation. They don't ask for increment.
Exactly. So automation is happening, and there I don't see a single conversation of the disruption which is waiting to happen because of unemployment, which is going to happen because of automation. That I think is something that we need to address. And self-employment, reskill and upskill, I think is the only way to go forward, because there is so much one can do. The internet has opened up education. One doesn't need to go into a traditional education institute and spend money. Here you have education in the form of MOOCs, massive open online courses, which is available free for everyone. Only the only thing that's stopping you is your desire and intent. You also mentioned about the startup community. We need to open them up, and because they are the ones who are doing some magical things, not just for themselves but for the country as a whole. Because you mentioned that how Israel's open policy is creating an ecosystem that is so beneficial. They have such a minuscule population, but they are a force to reckon with in the world when it comes to technology because of their policies. I hope and I wish that we at least emulate the good things which is happening around the world, and because that's the only way we will grow. Now, you have been writing insightful blogs and sending it to our policymakers over the 8 years you mentioned. What are your data, mails, ideas, insights which have been implemented by the policymakers so far? Can you talk about that?
In this last 7-8 years, only 3 or 4 occasions I got any acknowledgement from any minister. While talking of implementation of my suggestion, I have to be clear about one thing. No one in the world has a monopoly of suggestion. A thought which has occurred to me could have occurred to 1,000 other people at the same time. And 200 of them could have also written to the government or published in newspaper or on TV channel, whatever. Therefore, I cannot claim 100% ownership of any suggestion implementation. On January 2019, I wrote a blog called Keep Shouting, You Will Be Heard. 18th January 2019, Keep Shouting. And there, I'll very quickly read out suggestion which I thought partially got implemented.
Right.
Number one, remotely immobilizing a drone which has gone rogue. Number two, introducing entrepreneurship curriculum in government schools. EESL, energy efficiency, to switch over to wet leasing of electric cars instead of outright purchase. Introduction of mobile app Banmali. Banmali stands for banning malnutrition in India. To tackle malnutrition among children, 90% implemented. Word for word. In fact, I wrote an email called Thank You, Shrimati Menaka Gandhi. Next, to permit voluntary use of Aadhaar ID for eKYC by banks and mobile service provider. Implemented. Reducing air pollution in Delhi through a solution for stubble burning. Amritsar thing implemented. Forcing election candidates to reveal sources of their income. Method of real employment data in the country through a mobile attendance app, which I called From Bad to Mad. I still pitch for that every day. Then ISRO to transfer to private sector companies technology for lithium-ion battery, which they use on the rockets. Introduction of smart electric meters. Imported solar panel to attract zero import duty. Fitting a tablet behind each seat on a public transport vehicle. Bombay municipality is partially right. Implemented. Incentivizing housing societies to go green. I give a detailed proposal. An equitable formula for acquiring farmland for infrastructure projects. They were all held up. I say simply, make them equity partners in the SPV, all the farmers. Give them 3 times the price now, plus a share of the profit. They'll all willingly give their land. Partially getting implemented now. How to revolutionize India's healthcare system through the use of technology? Health sandbox, which I have been talking, Sharma is implementing, R.S. Sharma.
Right.
Making payment wallets interoperable. Satellite-based collection of highway toll through prepaid RFID in the vehicle, which is now taking place for the distant run. Now, this is the proof of concept of what I have been talking about, integrated transport, where a satellite will track 20 crore vehicles of India, every single one, 24/7, calculate its harm quotient. I have given a list of the 10 factor by on which you can calculate a half quotient, software calculate. And 6 times in an hour it will calculate half quotient, calculate average, and deduct payment every hour tax, which will replace road tax register every hour. This is also my passion, and beginning Nitin Gadkari has made a beginning. Then about the vehicle scrapping policy, I wrote Car Graveyard of the World in 2018. Suggest car graveyard. And I then suggested make along a junkyard or scrapyard or save yard in December 2023. Now government has accepted that port based like Alang. Alang is one of the ones chosen.
Right.
For scraping of vehicles. Vehicle scrapping policy, I have written dozens of blogs on that. One person company, Booth app has been introduced for Shoe Booth, which is a precursor of WhatsApp. Mobile based voting, for which for last 8 years, from 2012, 9 years, I have been advocating. It will come in Estonia. They have been voting through online for a number of years.
Right.
Many American districts and states have started voting on a mobile with a blockchain. So anyway, these are a few.
I just hope that the government starts acknowledging your effort, not just the government. I think the nation needs to acknowledge your effort. There are so many things that you have suggested, the ideas that you have shared, and which you said the list which has been implemented. So thank you for all your effort. Thank you from my side. Thank you from my listeners, because I think you're doing a great thing, and which is so far being unacknowledged. And I really wish and hope that the policymakers start, you know, giving the credit which is due. Now, I'll take the conversation towards pollution, because, you know, there's this report which suggests that India suffers most from pollution-linked deaths in the world. 2.5 million people die every year breathing toxic air pollution from fossil fuels. 22 of the most polluted cities in the world are in India. More than 1,16,000 babies in India die within a month of birth, have died within a month of birth in the year 2019 due to air pollution. So air pollution kills a child every 3 minutes in India. So it looks like a politician or the country don't really care about Indian lives. Besides that, there are state-owned companies such as Coal India, NTPC, ONGC, and private companies such as Reliance Industries, which are amongst the largest polluting companies in the world, which are still getting backed by the government with subsidies and financial support. So what should be done to highlight the importance and urgency of India's climate problem, and what steps needs to be taken to transition into clean energy?
I think that government has woken up to the issue, but it is like saying we appreciate the issue. Fragmentation of implementation of several ministries is holding back everything. Solar, we have an example. There is a power ministry, and there is the industry ministry, and there is the environment ministry, and all these are pulling in a different direction with the narrow focus, and maybe to hold close to the chest the powers which they have held all this time and not let go of that. Till that time all this goes, nothing is going to happen. Committees after committees are formed. In fact, there are 3 high-powered committees on technology only. I compiled the mandate of each of the committee, and I tabulated. I say, how much overlap? 3 committees, each consist of 10 to 12 scientists, engineers, topmost of the country, including Indians settled abroad, professors in MIT and Harvard and whatnot. I have a humorous definition of committee. Come, meet, tea. In fact, I said, if 5,000 years from now, somebody were to dig up a central vista in Delhi, and they will uncover cups and saucers, like Bonja Daro, and they will come to conclusion that, oh, here must be a room where there must be company, meeting and having a cup of tea. My 30 years experience in L&T, and I wanted to get something done, I would just call one person. He need not be even a person directly reporting to me. He may be three levels below me. I would call him and I say, I want this done. And I want this done by X date and in Y cost. And I am taking the responsibility of keeping your boss informed, your boss's boss informed. All you need to do is to tell the boss that HCP called me and he gave me the task and it got done. Today, such a thing doesn't happen. Solar is a solution. Can you imagine the energy cost in the balance sheet of any manufacturing company? Then you'll come to know. In a product cost, 8 to 10% cost is of the energy. And when it drops from 10 rupees to 1 rupee, can you make how much competitive it will make us all over the world? We can beat the world. We can become truly a low-cost economy. So I think taxing the polluters, encouraging those who find solution of reducing pollution, like by TransTax and harm quotient, or transmission, producing power, solar power in a desert area, transmitting 370 gigawatt from Kutch, Lahul, Spiti, to other parts of the country, storage battery, so that you can store them. I think these are the answers to our air pollution, water pollution, and even noise pollution.
Right. Yeah, there is so much that we can be done if we really think deeply, connect with the right people who have the right mindset, right technology and the tools and the right intentions. We can quickly transition from a fossil fuel consumption to a renewable energy source, which will bring about not just a cleaner environment, but which also transition us from ICE vehicles to EVs, and then, you know, solar vehicles and automated vehicles. So I'm really excited for where things are going, but, you know, we need more concerted effort. If you were the Prime Minister of India, what would be the policies that you would like to implement? What would be the steps that you would take to create a country which is more united, more cohesive? What would be your steps to create a future-ready India?
Too late for that. Why is it that you, I, billion other citizens of this country think that we can make a difference only if you occupy a position of power? Why do I have to be only a prime minister to start things? Even if I start sharing my constructive ideas with the rest of the world, and you're been watching my blog, where I market not only for cabinet minister and state chief minister, I market for all Rajya Sabha member, all Lok Sabha member, Niti Aayog people, think tanks, business leaders, economy. I think the list is about 2,000 people. And I should not think that there is one Sarkar Maba, Narendra Modi, inverted comma, who only poor fellow has the responsibility for initiating changes. That's not the way Sundar Bahugana thought, or Kailash Satyavarti thought, or Muhammad Yunus thought. They didn't think like that. And there are hundreds of other people in the country who are making such changes without waiting for something to trickle down from the top. In L&T, I kept on telling my subordinates, if you have a good idea, don't wait for asking me for my permission. Go and implement it. If there is a problem, Don't come to me with just a problem. You come to me with stating a problem, offering two solutions, solution A and B, and telling that you are going for solution B because of A, B, C. I should have to only know this way or this way. It's only contribution I should be making, nothing else. Because of maybe at my level, I have a better perspective than you might have at your level. So that's my answer to Prime Minister.
And one thing I would say, it's never too late, because, you know, we have technologies, tools such as age reversal. In your hand, I just recently interviewed somebody there's so many doctors or so many scientists who are working on age reversal, and there are some magical tools in our hand. So it's never too late. And I think you at this age are an inspiration. You have, for the last 8 years, have led by example and done things without looking or expecting anything for a monetary gain. Numbers of people in the world who want to bring about change because they're passionate about it, because they feel that the world can be better. Like a late President Abdul Kalam. I see that the efforts that you're doing. So I would only say that keep on doing what you're doing. Wish you the very best. Thank you for being part of
one
the show.
One more thing. I'm not going to let you go without asking question number 10.
Right.
What are the problems you are most passionate about solving?
Yes. My last question would be that. What are the problems that you are most passionate about?
I have listed in the descending order.
Right.
Of importance to me, personal importance.
Right.
It's a Sanskrit word.
Right.
And Mahavir, Lord Mahavir was called Arihan. Ari means enemy. Ant means destroyer. Destroyer of enemy. And from Elon Musk to Stephen Hawking, they're afraid that artificial intelligence will kill the mankind. It will go amok, run amok. And I have devised a concept, wearables like glasses,
right,
watches, mobile, picking up my thoughts. Okay, next, monetization of private and personal data, enable each of our 400 million users of social media to earn 30,000 rupees per month. Then simplified automatic compilation of employment data, that is third one.
Right.
Next, trans tax and harm quotient, which I just described earlier, integrated transport. Then mobile voting. Then a mobile app called grievance redressal, complaint redressal, called iSIM, uSIM.
Right.
Mobile app called Rom Paro MP, recall our member of parliament. Then electoral bonds and election funding. In the next one, which you are interested. AR, VR-based training, skilling and reskilling of millions from their homes. Education is going to undergo massive change. Already 1 year, we have now a pilot run going on, but that's now foundation on which we have to build. That millions need not go to schools, colleges, universities. They can just put on glasses and learn millions of skills which are broadcast through these glasses. In Mahabharata, there is a story of a boy called Ekalavya.
Right.
Belonging to Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe, OBC.
Right.
And he went to Dronacharya to say, teach me archery.
Archery.
Along with princes of Kaurava and Pandava. And Dronacharya said, you are OBC, a Scheduled Caste. I can't admit you. So what does he do? He goes to jungle, makes a straw statue of Dronacharya, sits there and learns archery, and learns it better than Arjuna.
Right.
That straw statue was ARVR.
Right. Yeah. Like, what a note to end on. I mean, you know, for me, the straw statue is the internet, because there is so much knowledge over there. It is transforming mankind. And you said about augmented reality, virtual reality. You also mentioned about brain computer interface, you know, and then you mentioned about monetization of data. These are things which are happening. And I think in the next few years, it's going to be inevitable. The education is going to get completely disrupted and transformed. What's been functioning is very primitive. And we are getting into the world where it's going to be interactive education, which is non-linear, where you will be personalized education. So I'm excited for the space. So thank you once again for being part of the Transform Impossible podcast. Thank you for being that change maker, that person that is going beyond and creating solutions and ideas and insights and sharing with the policymakers that so that the rest of India can benefit. Keep on doing what you're doing because you are a complete inspiration. I wish you the very best. I wish you also a very happy birthday in advance.
And same to you. You are following me.
Yeah, on the 28th. Yeah. So thanks a lot. It was a really pleasure and honor to be speaking to you. I really enjoyed the conversation. And I hope my audience would enjoy it as much. To my listeners, if you like what you see in here, please press the subscribe button. And until next time, see you guys. Bye-bye. Thank you.